season to just hear negative things about Eric and the victims. So to us, it was, you know, it was more about what we were trying to do, to put the focus on the real bad guys who have done this to all these people, not so much about like Erica being famous. The only part about the famous element is the fact that her platform is huge. And if she's willing to lend that, to point the finger at the bad guys, to put the spotlight on them, and in essence, help the victims, I mean, great. That's the whole point of it. That's the bottom line, you know. Will this big platform put the spotlight on the bad guys? For once, will a wife who didn't do the crimes get to flip the table? It's kind of like, it's very female empowering. I don't know if people really caught that, but that's what it was for us. That's why we're all smiling. Like, fuck yeah. Maybe a bunch of broads can take down a bunch of dudes who have been like running this patriarchal legal system for decades. Wouldn't it be kind of funny if someone who sort of plays like a Barbie doll, pretty, you know, super pretty, blonde hair, blue eyed, you know, mean girl sort of persona, team up with victims and take down the bad guys? That's pretty freaking great.
It is pretty great. I mean, did you get flack? I know the trolls, but did you get flack from, like, to your point, all the other victims that weren't there? Or no. Did they thought it was a good thing?
No. And some of them had questions or, you know, wanted to know first before they really had an opinion, like, how'd it go? Sort of some of the same kind of conversations that we just had today. You know, did you think she was sincere? What did the other people there think? You know, that kind of thing. Do you think she's really going to help victims? You know, do you think she'll really help put the focus on the bad guys, the people who helped steal our money or, you know, worked on our cases and knew it was being stolen and that kind of thing? Not to say that I speak to every victim, but the ones who talk to me or reach out to me, whether I know them or they see it and just reach out, I respond and talk to them if anyone has any questions and those sort of things. And there wasn't any negative backlash. You know, just mostly some of the fans of the TV show and some people who are following the legal parts of it. And there was a podcaster, I can't remember his name because I had never heard of him, but saying that, like, I use the victims, I use my dead son. Give me a fucking break. How do you use a dead child? First of all, I birthed my son. And I fought for him the entire time since I felt his death was unjust, I consider him when I make decisions that involve him, and I do the very best I can to try to think about how he would think and, you know, ask like his best friend or ask his old roommate or, you know, my daughters, what do you think, you know, Paul would think, that kind of stuff. We do that all the time. So to me, it's kind of a wild statement to tell a grieving mom, you're using your dead son. I mean, I would just say that my son was my biggest fan. And even if I wasn't doing the perfect or right thing, he'd be the first person to defend me. I would say that.
I don't even understand the logic of that, of how, I don't understand, like, what, to meet Erica? Like, I don't, to get like a, I don't understand how, like, I don't even understand the thought process.
Well, I don't either, especially because, I mean, obviously they don't know me or know any personal things, but my son, you know, worked craft services on TV and movie sets. He was an assistant chef. His dream was to own a restaurant. The restaurant where we had the event, that's my son's, like, it's the oldest restaurant in the valley. My son ran a deli in Woodland Hills before he worked on TV and movie sets. Like, it was his dream to have a bar like Cheers and a restaurant, like, everything about it, he would love it. So, having an ice cream company that makes people happy and gives money to charity, and we're doing it out of this restaurant that would be like, literally, if he were alive, it would be his dream. He'd be bugging me, Mom, let's buy the restaurant. Let's do it. Let's call this person. Let's do it. Let's figure it out. Let's get the owners to sell it. Da, 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 da. You know, it's wild to me because it was literally perfect. I mean, when I asked his old roommate, And I asked my daughters what they thought. They were like, he was loving every minute of that, especially the paparazzi. He would have been cracking up laughing at just sort of the scene and how it played out, you know, and people thought like, oh, they had a step and repeat. Hey, honey, you've never seen my events because I've been doing them for years and I've always had a step and repeat. We did not do that for Erica. I'm extra too. I worked for Tom. It wasn't by accident that me and Tom got along. I am extra. I am out there. Who doesn't love to throw a $100,000 party at the Four Seasons? Like, come on. I lived for that. That was like a dream come true. So it was my first event that I've done since I've stopped working with Tom. And I had to pay for it all myself and still try to pull off as good of an event as I did when I had a, you know, big budget. And we pulled it off and it was great.
So on the new season trailer of The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, which dropped, when Denise Richards says to Erica Jayne, you are truly a horrible woman, an evil woman, excuse me. You don't necessarily agree with Denise Richards in this situation.
Well, I can see why Denise feels that way. I can imagine, in the conversation, and I'm sure Erica, when she said it, didn't have, you know, $7 tickets to her show. So she realized, you know, some of the things she was saying could maybe, but that, you know, that's life. So, you know, I don't feel the same way that Denise, you know, does per se, but I can relate to why, you know, why she would say that. And I thought, you know, the trailer was pretty good. I mean, it was, I don't know, the whole breakup with Kyle. I'm not sure I believe any of that, but I'm not like a reality show expert. So I'm like, a, you know, armchair quarterback right now, you know, talking about it. But I thought, you know, like Lisa Rinna's gone and no one really seemed to miss her. And it seemed like they had made enough chemistry that there, you know, that there's some stuff for there to be drama and, you know, highs and lows or whatever for the season. And isn't that what fans want?
No one's talking about Lisa Rinna anymore. That's for sure. Are you, as we wrap up, two final questions. Are you going to, do you watch the show? Like, I know you said you don't really watch TV, but do you watch this just because you are, you know, it is like a constant reminder. And is that hard? Like you said, we're now in our third season of this. Like, you're like, let's, you know, if Erica were a private person, Tom were a private person, you wouldn't be constantly reminded of this. I mean, it would still be going on, but not to such a mass degree.
Right. I do watch the show a little bit now, not saying I watch every episode, the whole entire thing. But I would say I've watched a majority of the episodes since all this happened, because it is a little more interesting to me. And also because, you know, I've now met people involved in Bravo World and I follow some people on Instagram and I see all the stuff. And it's the first time in like 20 years since I started doing the type of work I do that I